another episode of the Emerging Market Entrepreneur. Today we have a very special guest. We have Mohammed Dewji from Tanzania and the CEO and President of METL, Mohammed Enterprises Limited in Tanzania. Mo, thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you very much, Sid.
And of course, my co-host.
Thank you, Sid. Today we're going to talk about, what are we going to talk about today, Sid?
Today we are going to talk about navigating turbulent times, as always, and we're going to get Mo's perspective. But before that, Mo, why don't you, you're a very well-known person in Africa, but for people that are not familiar with you, can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Yes. So basically, I was born in Tanzania in a small town called Singida, which was located centrally. And I am a fourth generation Indian that basically migrated from India in the late 1800s into Africa. And then the family, you know, had a mom and pop shop doing a lot of retail business that kind of grew. My father did very, very well when, and then we all went to good universities. I went to Georgetown, studied finance and international business. And when I joined him, I mean, he was doing almost $30 million revenue. So he was a wealthy man. But at that time, he was into more of just a trading environment and trading goods. And today, METL is still one of the largest trading houses in Eastern Central Africa. And when I say trading, I mean soft commodities, sugar, rice, fertilizer, but also pigeon peas, cocoa beans, coffee, cotton, yellow gram, green mung, beeswax, gum arabica, etc., etc. At the same time, we are also trading imported products, products that are not manufactured in Tanzania or in the region where there's an opportunity, we trade. So that's one silo. And then when I got back from university, I realized that, okay, so what is my strategy? My strategy was at that time, today, Tanzania, we have just made it, the World Bank announced us as a middle income economy. But and when you're still talking about a middle income economy, you're talking about $1,200 a year, you know? And at that time, the number was less than half. And I was thinking, okay, so, you know, what would someone do with $50 in his pocket per month, you know, and what should I be targeting? And at that time, there was a lot of talk about value addition and about employment. And I was very, I had a lot of empathy to the fact that the population did not have the employment. So we went a lot into manufacturing, and we have almost now 40 industries, mainly food products, and, you know, competing with Unilever, Procter & Gamble, Coca-Cola, so edible oils and cooking fats and grain milling, wheat milling, maize milling, we're into plastics, into textiles, totally integrated textiles that employs a lot. So that's the second silo. So that's the step that I took forward, and then we went into agri. We're one of the largest landowners. We're doing cashews, so we process cashews. We trade raw cashews. We are into sisal. We make sisal yarn. We make sisal bags. We're into tea, so tea processing, et cetera, et cetera. And then we're into logistics also. We have thousands of vehicles. But the biggest advantage of METL over others was that we have distribution countrywide. And it's a one-stop shop, you know. When a farmer comes in, he wants to sell corn or maize. I buy it. I give him the money. What does he do with it? We go back to the bottom of the pyramid. That what is that I was targeting? 80% of the $50 that he needs to spend is on products that I manufacture. And that thus, we have the Mo brand, and we touch people's lives on a daily basis. When someone wakes up in the morning, you know, when he drinks his cup of tea, we're into the tea business, we're into the sugar business, you know. He, you know, goes and he showers, we're in the soap business, you know. He sits down, he eats a chapati, which is something in Kiswahili, or bread. We're in the flour business. We're in the cooking fat business and margarine business. So the whole day, the bicycle he rides, you know, the women, the kanga, the African printed wear there, they wear, we manufacture it all. So we touch the lives of Tanzanians and now Eastern Central Africans on a day-to-day basis. So that's the background. And of course, we grew this business, and we We're about 1.6 billion in revenues. And that's the story, you know. So this is my last 20 years plus of hard work together with my management and the employees.
That's absolutely an amazing story. Thanks for sharing that with us. Alex, I know you're waiting to ask a question, but I'm gonna jump in there and ask the first one. So how does, you know, this is a massive empire, and you've given the story of how you grew from a 30 million trading house into this household name brand conglomerate. How does entrepreneurial thinking drive some of the new business ventures that you've gotten into? So this is a family business, but what is the, can you define the entrepreneurial spirit within your organization?
You see the spirit at that time, you know, there are two different types of spirits. Today, you see the new world, you're talking about IoT, Internet of Things, you're talking about, you know, platforms, you're talking about tech. You see majority of billionaires today are coming from these type of industries. But when you know, when you take us back 20 years back, you know, you are looking at an economy when people, you could not even imagine that people could own cell phones at that particular time. And I have few regrets, whether it is the not getting into the banking industry or not getting into the, you know, cell phone business industry. These are my regrets. But my entrepreneurial thinking at that particular time was that, look, why if my father was trading flour, why can I not buy wheat and millet and sell flour and also sell the wheat brand to cattle as cattle feed, for example? Why would we not, instead of buying finished product, bring in crude and refined? So, you know, before he would bring in palm oil in jerry cans, and now we bring in crude and then you refine it, you get stearin. With stearin, you can make two things. You make cooking fats, you make margarines, and then you also can put some of that to make a good quality soap. Together, you get 5% of palm fatty acid distillator that you make this bar soap that people use. I mean, in the past, 20 years ago, this bar soap, they would use it for utensils, they would use it to wash their bodies, they use it for everything, basically. And then as purchasing power gets better, they want toilet soap for their bodies, they want liquid soap, they want detergent. So now when the detergent space, and you know, we've been competing with Omo and Ariel, and we've got over 50% market share and liquid soaps, and now we have this type of this is a sanitizer, but we have a similar type of soap that you press and then the foam comes out, you know. So it's you try to be innovative, but end of the day you have to understand one thing, that the reason that why I have been able to compete with these multinationals, the thought process is to be able to produce very, very efficiently, very, very efficiently, you know, efficiency. And you cannot afford to have huge costs in terms of manpower or fixed costs like multinationals do, because you're not going to get that price, because the market is very, very price sensitive. You know, when I'm competing with Coke or, you know, with Red Bull, you know, Red Bull has 250 ml in a can, but I put it in a PET. The can, basically the gas lasts longer. Okay, there's a longer shelf life. But you see, but I know that I'm turning around my product within 2-3 weeks, and I know my shelf life is three months. Good enough. I can produce it for less. I will give 400 ml. They're selling it for a euro, a dollar, and I'm selling it for 25 cents, for example. You know, so I'm giving more quantity, lesser price, you know, and that's where I'm winning in the game.
Very interesting. So now basically the pandemic hit.
Yes.
You have lower fixed costs and you are in sort of essential services.
Yes.
Be super well positioned.
So I'll tell you something, that unlike many companies that they've been hit majorly. So it's not entirely all very rosy for sure. But first, Tanzania never went into a lockdown, number one. And number two, Tanzania is surrounded by 8 countries, which pretty much a lot of them depend on the Dar es Salaam port, right? Number two. Number three, you know, with any lockdown, you know, end of the day, people have to eat and people have to shower and people have to. So we actually, you know, we have a plant that makes hair creams and, you know, face creams and hair gels. And we suddenly converted that line into manufacturing sanitizers, for example, you know, so we took advantage of that. We have a textile mill where we make, you know, yarn, we spin, we weave, and we process and we mercerize. And we decided, we have a garmenting section. So we decided, okay, you know, the pull on t-shirts or polo shirts, the demand is low. So we went into masks manufacturing. We did that in Tanzania. We did that in Mozambique, et cetera, et cetera. We went into trying to manufacture PPE materials, et cetera, et cetera. But in short, the food line of products was not hurt in terms of volume or quantity. Of course, there were big jerks in the market. You know, you see fuel going down, people panicking, you know, you lose money here and you lose money there, it's fine. But all in all, my logistics business got stuck because we were open while Rwanda was closed, for example. Zambia was closed, had a lockdown. Kenya had a lockdown. So my logistics and transit business had to be blocked because of drivers, you know, testing positive for COVID. So you had those type of challenges, you know. And so we had our challenges. But overall, I would say as a group, we never thought we could work from home. And initially, you know, actually we lost a couple of employees through COVID. Someone from the corporate office, we had to shut down the corporate office for almost, a month. It was very sad. He had an underlying disease also. But a lot of them also got. And then we finally decided to take life insurance now for all our employees. But, you know, the sticking point was always there that, you know, that, you know, it's like what India has done or what Pakistan has done. You know, I mean, people stay home. It's a matter of you survive the COVID or you survive, you know, having no food, you know. So it's a very thin line, you know, when your purchasing power or per capita income is so low, you know. So we came up with very strong systems where we did give them a lot of protective gear, but the business went on, you know, there was a lot of, you know, caution, but the business went on, and thank God things have simmered down now back home, and things have opened up again and tourism has opened up again. But as a country, yes, we were hurt because we get revenues of about $1.8 billion from tourism because of Kilimanjaro and Serengeti, and that blocked it. Then foreign currency blocked. That means that squeeze came into the currency, like what happened to the rand went up to 19, for example, right? So we
still
didn't
get there.
Yeah, oh, it's still there. We didn't get that badly, but we lost few percentage points. And then when if you're borrowing in US dollars, and this is just an example of the evaporation of money, because your revenues are in shillings or Tanzanian shillings and you repay back in dollars. This is how you lose money sometimes, you know?
Of course. Yeah, no, it's still to the euro. It's been hectic. So, but I mean, what you're basically saying, if I can summarize a little bit, is, I mean, you've been in a very strong position to actually deal with this crisis. You have lower fixed costs than your competitors, because that's been your business model. You're very empathetic to what your local market needs. So you're very quickly to adapt to the new market trends.
Right.
And I think the third thing is you just in an essential service, which is by pure luck. If you would have been now in another line of business by accident, then obviously that's nothing you can influence. So basically, because of those three aspects, you're very well positioned to deal with this crisis. But now, if you think of other entrepreneurs that are listening to the show and that are thinking, yeah, man, but you know, I'm not a billionaire. And I'm not, I don't have an empire like you have, Mo. You know, what should I do now? I don't sell food. Yes. My fixed costs are high. And what am I supposed to do now, Mo?
You see, I think, you know, today, you in today's world now, you have to think of being a disruptor, number one. And I believe we never thought that we could work from home, but we all managed. I mean, I never thought that, you know. I mean, I wasn't feeling comfortable. And as a matter of fact, I am locked down in the UAE, and I've been running cash flow meetings, management meetings, et cetera, et cetera. So disruption, I'll give you a small example. You know, you're running a business, you think, okay, you're in the UAE, you've got these big buildings, and you have like people climbing up all these buildings, you know, try to, you know, clean buildings, right? And, you know, what's going to happen in 6 months, in 1 year, you'll see no people going up there because A, is dangerous, B, is costly, C, they will probably have drones that were going to, you know, spray stuff on the building and wipe and do everything. Everything is going to be all remote control. So that's number one. So disruption, you know, innovation, tech, we ourselves are getting into an Amazon type of a model. Because, you know, we're like, okay, we're dealing with the wholesalers and the sub-wholesalers. But when we realize the difference price between a wholesale price that I'm selling and a retailer that buys, the guy is paying 20% more. Now, imagine today if the guy, his income is $100. If you can save him $20 by creating a platform, okay, maybe, you know, you'll save him $15. It's going to cost you $5 to deliver. But still, A, you are in the money because you're getting a higher realization, and he's in the money because he's saving money. So right now, as we speak, we're talking, we are engaging people, we're creating a platform, and not only necessarily like trying to sell products that are only METL-related products, because we only have 150 products. So, you know, if you want to buy a plastic chair, I'm not in the plastic chair manufacturing business, but, you know, I can source and I can sell and I can make that margin, all tech related, you know. And yes, coming back to your question, that I think costs, we have to control costs. I need, you know, they see, we have to get into this culture of not spending as much as what we used to spend. And we just, because, you know, now I think I believe the value of money is becoming, although I just read an article in The Economist, I mean, S&P, the second quarter, I mean, it's been up the highest in the last
Since 1998. Best quarter on record since 1998.
Yeah. So there's a difference between the Wall Street and the marketplace. Yeah. But, you know, when fundamentally, I think, you know, cost control, you have to be very, very cautious. But at the same time, you know, when you talk to me about cost control, you know, I run things because the poor guy just gets a very small salary, and I will run it even if I know temporarily I will lose money, but I will do it just so that he can just retain his job, because we also believe in impact investing, you know. Mm-hmm. Yes, and impact investing doesn't mean necessarily making losses. But, you know, but you have to have the capacity to do it. But if you don't make your cash flows and you don't have money in your pocket, you have to take those stringent decisions.
So, Mo, let me ask you a question. So you talked a little bit about work from home and that sort of thing. How do you think that, and then, of course, you talked about the Amazon type business model and the fulfillment business of other products. You have a very strong logistics network. Do you think that COVID-19 has forced you to think about digital transformation more seriously? Because a business like yours deals in a lot of physical commodities and goods. So, how does technology, and, you know, to take it a bit further, the markets that you're operating in may not have digital penetration or disposable income to the levels that you see in the emerged world. So, has this forced you to think about digital transformation differently?
For sure. So I was just thinking, this is a good question, Sid. I was thinking, okay, let's say, God forbid, that there was a lockdown in Tanzania and I'm into fast moving consumable items, right? And now if there's a lockdown, that means your wholesaler shop is closed, your sub wholesaler's shop is closed, and probably your retailer's shop is closed. You know, when I say retailer, I mean someone who sells, let's say, you know, I don't know, 10 boxes of soap, you know. Mm-hmm. So I started getting worried, of course. I started saying, dude, I need to get connected to the end consumer, you know? So besides the margin saving, and that's where the whole thing, you know, thought process started, you know, that look, people have to change. Although sometimes we feel, look, the education level for many sub-Saharan African countries is very low, internet penetration is very low. But when you're looking at the business model, you're looking 10 years, 20 years from today, it's like, you know, there were times when you thought that, you know, a bus driver would never be able to afford a phone, let alone, now he has bundles. He has a smartphone and he's connected and he's smart. There's M-Pesa going on, you know, and we are creating our own platform for Mo-Pesa. That is also happening. So I believe, yes, it has given me a shock, you know, to try to kind of think and go outside and think beyond the box.
So is it fair to say that the next major investment you'll make is in hiring engineering staff and AI for technology development?
For sure. We have that going on, and also a lot of regional expansion that's going to happen. I had a very good discussion with some leaders in Rwanda also. Things are happening in Mozambique, also in Kenya. So we're looking at businesses that we are strong in, and that we believe that we have some type of an advantage of going in there because we have anchor businesses that are in Dar es Salaam. And let's say Rwanda is stuck. So, you know, I'll be more competitive than someone else because I have my own facility, whether it may be fuel, whether it may be, you know, grain, or because I'm in the port, you know, and then it all goes through the Dar es Salaam port. So we're looking at also regional expansion. Yeah.
If you look at all these digitalization, and you are really taking it and really pushing it now, which is great to see that, you know, someone so successful as you is now really also adapting and changing and looking ahead into the next 20 years.
Right.
But if you would start all over again, what would you do? If you would have to start all over again, you have, you know, zero in your pocket, what would you do now?
Okay, so I would still do what I am, what I've done, of course, because you see, I don't think I've made, of course, I've made mistakes. Any entrepreneur in the world cannot tell you that they've not made mistakes or not lost money, et cetera, et cetera. But I think that I would have done what I'm trying to think today, 5 years ago, because the tech industry had already started, you know, having a boost. I would have done that 5 years ago. I would have definitely gone into a banking system, not necessarily brick and mortar, but rather more of a digitalized banking where, you know, you have wallet, people have, you know, banking accounts from their phones, you know, the cellular industry, of course. Again, we're looking at an MVNO structure because I own a football club, et cetera, et cetera. So these are the 2-3 areas where I think that I should have made a move far earlier than I've done, and that, okay, I still don't believe that I've totally missed the boat. I might have missed the boat in terms of the large margins people made before, but I still think margins are going to remain as long as you're going to be competitive.
But you wouldn't go into the restaurant business right now?
No. I think, you know, for me, retail, you know, like, you know, restaurant businesses, you know, I mean, there's something like real estate also. I'm quite weak in real estate. It doesn't go into my mind much, you know, I'm not much, although I own a lot of real estate by default, because you see what happens, we give open credit, we give credit to people, and this runs in hundreds of millions. Basically, I operate like a semi-bank, you know. So, for example, you know, Alex, you come to me and you tell me, okay, Mo, I've got $10,000, but, you know, I see the opportunity. I can see that you can do, you know, maybe $1 million of revenue a year. You know, that means you can kind of, so I will give you a credit and then I'll take a check. I'll take a personal guarantee. If the credit limit is too big, I will take, you know, your house as a collateral, you know. And then tomorrow, God forbid, Alex, you default on me, you know, I suddenly have real estate, you know. So I haven't gone into real estate wantingly, but maybe by default, I would say.
So we're getting to that point where we're almost out of time. So let me ask another question. We've you mentioned you were in the UAE. We've just come out of a 14-day lockdown, and then things are going a bit back to normal. But how is your routine, your personal routine? I know you're a fitness fanatic. How has your personal routine evolved in the times of corona?
Of course. I, because routine is one, but also I'm a Muslim, so I have to. The Ramadan was fantastic for us because I got to spend a lot of time with my kids, and it was so the routine got changed. I got a lot of time to invest in my children, which was fantastic. You know, we're talking about geopolitics, current affairs, and it's so amazing that to see the kids. Today's kids are so much more smarter than what we were when we were their age, you know. But the routine has come back to normal again. You know, you wake up for prayers. And as you know, UAE is getting really, really hot. So I go for a 10K run right after the prayers at about 5:30. I do it within about 54 minutes, 55 minutes. And then I walk for about 20 minutes. While I'm doing all this, I'm listening to a lot of prayers, which is kind of gives me a lot of, you know, kind of calmness. You know, I come back and then I start, you know, I don't run to the office as I used to when I used to be back home. So I start clearing my emails and reading a lot of reports, etc., etc. By the time the missus is up, you know, by the time she'll make the breakfast, and I'll have the breakfast and then head to the office. But definitely the working hours have gotten shorter. But, you know, while saying that, you know, when you are an owner of an enterprise, you know, that means there's no timing. I mean, you can have, and that sometimes the missus gets upset, you know, because I'm in a call at from 10 o'clock to 11 and we're in bed. You know, and she has to listen to all that nonsense, right? And then she will tell me, "Can you go out and speak?" Right? By the time, so it's lesser hours, but you know, we're always working. You know, always working. Yeah.
Fantastic. Mo, thank you so much for your time, and look forward to connecting and catching up with you again very soon.
Thank you, Alex. Thank you, Sid. And what you guys are doing is good. God bless you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mo, for your great insight for the other entrepreneurs and in emerging markets, and in particular in Africa. You're a role model.
Perfect. Thank you, sir.